Hello, thank you so much for joining us. Today we're talking about an issue that's really close to a lot of people's hearts. It's affecting every person in Zambia as I speak right now. The issue of gender-based violence. In the past few weeks, we saw in the media that a man, an elderly couple, a man, the husband, had actually killed his wife using a hammer. We don't know how exactly, but the fact that it was over 6,000 kwacha. When you weigh the two, a life of your spouse with 6,000 kwacha material, I don't know how that works out for people watching out there, but I don't think it is right. Gender-based violence is real and it's living in Zambia, it's living among us. Now, when we talk about gender-based violence, we always think it's about the man beating the woman. Well, it's the woman also beating the man. It's about verbal abuse. It's about sexual abuse. It's all forms of abuse as long as it's affecting you and it's making you sad. Now, I have some statistics here. In the first 6 months of 2014, which is last year, Zambia recorded 8,000 cases of gender-based violence against women and men, girls and boys. And we have also women activists who have been speaking about this. They've been going on about this. If I get, for example, Sarah Lungwe, who said the situation in Zambia has worsened. And this is because some women go to the police and come back and get their husbands. And victims do not even report cases in some situations. Again, a child rights and gender focal point officer, who is Anna Sampa, also said that more information is really important to gather and seal the loopholes that are affecting and surrounding gender-based violence in our country. This is a very sad situation, and on today's program, I have the privilege to speak to a woman who was in a very abusive relationship for 13 years. Her name is Mutinta, and she's going to give us details of how this exactly poured out. And of course, we also talk about music. We have the Musicians United, and they are going to tell us how they are preaching the One Zambia, One Nation slogan to really just build peace, build love among citizens in our country. And I will take you to Elis Joy as well. And this time we're going to see how we can turn that black dress into something that you can wear in the daytime and the nighttime. So this is one for 360 for today. Stay tuned. All right, so let's now sit down with Mutinta as she tells us her story of what exactly she went through, how she feels about gender-based violence. You have medical personnel telling you what impact it has on your psyche, what it really would do to you as a person. But let's get it from somebody who's been through it. What message does she have for people out there? And if you're in a relationship like that, you might just get one or two things. Let's talk to Mutinta. Now, we are talking gender-based violence, and when people hear that, the only thing they think of is beating. And usually it will be beating of male to female. Firstly, give us your general feel about gender-based violence.
I think people got a wrong picture of it because it's comprised of all facets of abuse, to be emotional, physical, verbal, economical. It's all aspects. I think it's very progressive on the woman part.
Mm-hmm. And when you look at it in the context of our country, Zambia, how deep do you think it is?
It's very prevalent, Judy, very. I've had the privilege to research, and I've just realized how huge the issue is.
Okay. Now, let's go to your story. Tell us about your relationship with this man that you stayed with for 13 years.
I thought I was in love. It's a person I thought would cherish me for the rest of my life. Someone I shared a bed with, my life, everything. I think it turned out to be the most worst nightmare of my life. He was abusive, very early in our marriage.
How early?
6 months into my marriage, can you imagine?
That was less than a year.
Yes, just 6 months into our marriage. I remember the first time it happened, I think I was in shock. I didn't want to believe it. I didn't tell anyone about it.
That was what, the beating or?
The beating. Mm-hmm. He apologized, I forgave him. I thought it would never happen again. But it happened a year later, Judy. This time I had a broken nose, torn lips, bruised face. I covered up again. I didn't tell her so. But then, when we had our first child, a year plus later, you can imagine, I was holding that baby in my hand, nursing that child. He hit me.
So you mean the time he did that twice, you were pregnant after?
The second time I was.
Okay.
Then the third time, I was actually having a baby. I had a baby in my arms. He didn't care about the baby in my arms. Just started hitting me, hitting me. He almost blinded me.
But why? What was causing these fights? I mean, people who are in relationships, who are in marriages, all fight. But what would lead to it being physical?
Personally, I think there's a psychological aspect to it. These are businesses need help. And it's unfortunate in Zambia we don't have such a facility. I think the government should look into this and open a rehabilitation center for these abusers. Because I think prison doesn't do it for them.
Okay. Tell me, that was like a year into your marriage. What about the other forms of abuse the rest of the years? Because you stayed with him for 13 years.
Yes, Judy.
What other forms of abuse?
Initially, it was the physical abuse. Mm-hmm. After my family called him, spoke to him, he changed, but now it became verbal. And you know it is, Judy, when you keep hearing something for a long time, you tend to believe it, huh? You tend to accept it. He made me feel like trash. He told me such words like, you're a dumbass, you're good for nothing. I was always this vibrant person, but suddenly I became withdrawn. I was withdrawn from society, from my friends, from my family. They didn't know what was happening to me. But eventually, I became a shadow of myself. I lost my identity, my self-worth. I just didn't like being alive. I hated myself.
But, Mutinta, 13 years, that's a very long time. And that abuse started in your first year. What gave you the courage to go on?
Probably guilt.
Guilt about what?
I blame myself. I thought I chose the wrong person to be my partner. And then I wondered, what do people say? Just 6 months into my marriage, you know? There's the traditional aspect. I remember I told one of my aunties about it, and then she said, oh, just be Kisha, you know, these things happen in marriage. Just survive it, to stop. And I thought it would, Judy, but it never did. It went on.
Talking about that, Mutinta, well, how do you feel about society's perspective when they look at a marriage and which doesn't work? And do you think they always blame the woman regardless?
They do. I was blamed, Judy. Even the time I took the first step to report the matter to police, mm-hmm. I was castigated for it. I was blamed by my family, by other friends. Mm-hmm. Said a woman shouldn't do that, you know. Should always honor your husband. But at the end of the day, my life was in danger. So I think society, we need to change, Judy. We need to. And we need to stand up as women.
Okay. What about the other forms of abuse you went through? Tell me about that. You told me about the verbal abuse. You told me about the physical abuse as well. Are there any other forms of abuse that you went through?
After I'd reported the matter to the police, I used to do the case because of pressure from family. Mm-hmm. Then the worst part was the sexual abuse now. He had affairs outside the marriage, you know, where he would find me sleeping, he would come very late, and then he would wake me up, you know. If I don't wake up, he would hit me, beat me up. He would force me to listen to his sexual escapades with other women, you know, what he was doing to other women. It was very, I could have strangled him. It was painful.
When you look at a woman who is in a situation that you were in that time, what would you tell them?
To get out, Judy. It's not worth their lives.
But society will always have that blame. You were courageous enough after 13 years to leave that relationship. Others may not have the financial muscle, may not have the same courage and confidence. What word of inspiration, what word of strength can you give them?
First thing I'll tell them, Judy, they need to open up, share it with somebody. Somebody you can trust, somebody can help you. I had to do this. I had to share it with the pastor. It helped spiritually. I also reported to the victim support unit. As of now, I'm still undergoing counseling, Judy. I'm still going through therapy. because the pain is still there. I still have scars on my body of the abuse. It's not easy. So the best thing a woman can do is to speak up. Tell the family, inform your friends what you're going through.
What eventually made you just up and go after 13 years? What was the last blow? What was the final thing that you could just not take it anymore?
He almost killed me. My son saved me.
He used to beat you in front of your kids?
He did that several times. Even now, I'm still planning to take my children for therapy. They still have nightmares, Judy. Don't sleep well in the night. If you call my four-year-old son, you'll be able to narrate what happened.
Is he the one you were saying that was the final blow and he saved you?
Yes.
What did he do?
He got me, tied me up. I couldn't scream. Then he hits me with the grill door. You know those grill doors, huh? Iron bars. Then he got a hole. You know, he wanted to just like kill me. My son helped me.
What did he do?
He pulled the hole from behind. Could have been hurt today. So the time he took hold of the hole, I ran out of the house. I managed to open the door, get out. Somebody picked me. It was around 02. He took me to the university teaching hospital. I was admitted for 2 days. And I thought, God, it's not worth my life. I have to get out of this for the sake of my babies. I had to leave Judy to tell my story, to help some other woman out there.
How many children do you have?
3.
Is that with him, all of them?
No, I have casted off them.
Okay. All right. Now, I know you told me before we came on set, before we were on air, that you're writing a book. Tell me about that.
Now, for a long time, that man made me feel so ugly. I felt I was worth nothing. I lost my self-esteem. But then I realized I could be much more, Judy. I'm worth so much. So I thought of writing this book because from the research I've done, you know, when women go through abuse, you lose your confidence, huh? You hate yourself, you just have this self-loathing, you know? My main objective of writing this book is to inspire women to tell them they're beautiful, Judy. They can achieve so much. And that's why I'm telling everyone I'm a treasure and not the trash you told me I was.
Ah, and what is the title? That's the title, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, I'm a treasure, not trash.
Beautiful, beautiful. So when you think of gender-based violence now, do you look at it in the same light as the time you were there?
No, I think it's rampant. I'm still doing research for my book. Women are in pain, too. They're dying inside. They're in pain. But one thing I've realized, they don't want to talk about it. And fellow women are helping to just like propel this vice. So I think as women, we need to get together, you know, stand up together and fight this. We can do it, Judy.
When you were going through that, let me take you back a little bit. What was the one thing that kept you strong?
My faith in God. Mm-hmm. Because every time I'd be in pain, that's how I came up with the book. I'd write down how I felt.
Oh, so the book is like the diaries of the what you were going through.
It's a project I've not gone for about 3 years.
Okay.
So whenever I was in pain, I couldn't sleep in the night, I'll try it.
Okay. Tell me about your publicist. He's a very good man. I've met him before. Tell me how you met and how you're working together with this book. Trash. Treasure, not trash.
I'm a treasure, Judy.
Yes. So tell me about you, how you met and how you're working on this project together.
We were on some interview.
Mm-hmm.
I was actually doing some interviews. And then he just told me, Tinta, you're so beautiful. I burst into tears. Because I hadn't been told that for a long time, you know? I believed I was ugly. And he just said, Tinta, you're so beautiful. I shed tears. It was strange, not somebody telling me I'm beautiful. And I said, why? Then I explained to him. I said, how? How come you've managed not to survive this long? I said, I write my feelings down, my pain, I write. So I showed him what I wrote. He said, girl, we need to publish this. We need to tell the world about this. Why not? Let's go for it.
Okay. So when do we expect the book out?
July.
July. Mm-hmm. Okay, all right. No, Mtinta, thank you so much for coming through and sharing your story once again. I know it's a personal thing, but I do appreciate it. Thank you so much. And is there anything else you'd like to tell the woman out there, the man out there, because gender-based violence is, you know, affecting both, and it's affecting families and everyone, basically.
It is very sad, Judy. If you look back, the past 2 weeks, women died because of this.
Yes, of course.
If you had an opportunity to ask those women, they could have told you what was going on in their lives. I believe it was ongoing. So I think it's not worth being there. If you keep holding on to the marriage and the abuse, your survival is hanging in the balance. So I suggest get out. Get out for your kids, for the women out there.
Okay. Tinta, thank you once again.
Thank you, JD.
All right. All right, you are still watching Woman 360, and quite a very emotional chat they have had with Mtinta. I really cannot imagine having to hear sexual escapades of your partner being told to you, whether you like it or not, in the fact that it's already wrong, but being forced to hear it is really another issue. We are talking gender-based violence on Woman 360. We take a break. Join me on the other side. All right, now Chanda Mwanga is a colleague of mine. He's a producer and he worked on a piece. He did a documentary that talks about gender-based violence. Let's see this short clip and join me on the other side.
Dwara kujabezo chitawa kabwela chabele ni ndio so chabele kabwela ni ndio ni kumenye wa ini chabele na papu nishinilibe utaibu manja kulingana ti ii ni mene nilipanu mtu huo dwara nili HIV positive nikaangana pavana futi nikazingawa na maganizo deiki nima ono manga tichima ni vutisa nda kumbuyo kunezo genza na zozi pae tikapena nife chabele nisazuna kwa vene pichitika
nikala choku mduisa. Ngati these days ni almost every day pa TV uzaona kuti mzimai amenyewa mzimai apaiwa mwana achitwa default every day anchamechi dandaulisa chamba kunio ofya munga ini munga mzimai nikuti vintu vamba koneka munga tajaira ni normal pa news every day uzamvira kuti mzimai amenyewa mzimai apaiwa ero bankala ni normal part of our life so icho ni chintu chamene sichifunika kuti tipitilize tifunika kupeza solution. Elo ina nguvuto ya meniona, kambili olo munga mkani za chikwati. Olo imu ingati mfuna timdero muenda mchikwati. Wazatenga mzimai, wa mkalike mnyumba 1 month. Kumupunzisa kutuku nkala na mwamuna niso. Kukondwelesa mwamuna niso. Mwamuna ni chakudia, mwamuna ni ichi. Koma, mwamuna swaza mtenga kumuza kuti mzimai. Njira yonkalila nae niso. Mwai wanavuto pa mene ipeze kira.
Na tule funda wa namayo, tule bonfia ya nama verses ya mbaibo ya kulando kutila. Namayo afiro kubela, a woman has to submit to the husband. So bashibantu nomba wamono kutila kanshi namayo, ena chonsefie kuti ababela. Chonsefie, nangupa fimbu usafie suivi in our own culture, ero nangu tatulilanda pabu na Kristo. Bale vika haina mano muli shibantu, ero muli namayo, nangubale mwe kutila iwo mulumewe, ngalanda fiefi, nangu akola, iwo kubela fi. So if you feel that gender-based violence, namayo okufuma fe kubwa icho wako bale mufunda okutira uli munono tapali ifyo wama iwe uli mwana kashifia boy child na bale mu bokutira iwe ni leader iwe ni mukalamba iwe ni mtu wanganda kutuwa chite fili fiance. So if you feel nga kutira bana mayo ili ngiri ne bale bachinchintira mera kwata shirensa mbusha kuba abaka kuka.
A lot of ripple effects when it comes to gender-based violence. That piece there just shows you how deep, how grave GBV can be and what impact it can have on someone's life. Let's just now go to Elise Joy. If you've been through this or you're going through this, get that black dress in your wardrobe and see how much you can play with it just to boost your mood, just to boost your morale. It might just help you get out of a situation that you think is irredeemable. So let's just go to Jore as she tells us what that dress black can do in the daytime and nighttime.
Okay, hello, my name is Jore from Elise Joy Boutique Salon and Spa. Today we're going to talk about how to change your day look into a night look. This is a black dress. Now, there are certain times maybe because of your budget, you can't afford to buy new outfits all the time, or maybe you want, you're going straight from work to the function and there will be no time to change up. So I'll just kind of give you a few tips of how to change that outfit that you were wearing at the office to just make it look okay for the night. So these are the, my two models. You can see Matilda here is wearing just the simple normal dress that you can wear at the office, and her makeup is not all flashy, minimal jewelry, no makeup, and I mean no earrings and necklaces, and normal shoes. If you want, you don't have to wear flats. You can have your usual day look high shoes. Then we have Elizabeth, who has, I guess, a typical black dress. Now, most of the time when we say, like the title of this thing is black dress, but you don't have to wear black dresses all the time when you're going out. It's just for the sake of convenience that we say it's a black dress. But what she's wearing is just a normal dress with flat shoes. Again, you don't have to wear flat shoes. You can wear your normal shoes. Her look is okay for the office. So we'll just show you how to change these two basic looks into a day, into a night look. Oh, I also have, I forgot about myself, I'm also wearing something that you could wear to the office. At least I can wear this where I work, but I'm sure other people, this is a little bit too much. So we'll just show you how we can change up these looks into night time. So as you can see, we've just done a few changes to our day look. So I'll start with Matilda. She just put on statement heels. This will make sure that she's noticed when she enters the room. She's put on some bracelets, a nice cocktail ring, and she's updated from the day handbag to a clutch that you wear at night. And you can even see she's added on some bling. And then before I forget, one thing you have to do, because it's at night, during the day your makeup is minimal. So at night you can add on maybe a bit more around the eyes, add on more shimmer in the eyeshadow. If you have lipstick, during the day maybe you just put one coat, at night you can, it's okay for you to pile it on, and whatever color you want, then just change up, put some blusher if you want. And her hair is on point. Then we just talk about Elizabeth. This is the same black outfit that she had. Now this is one of those things that if there's a function in the evening, you can, these are items that you can easily carry in your handbag. You don't have to rush home and change. So she's wearing, you can see from her shoes, they are not basic, normal, boring ones. They say, I am here. She's changed, instead of the structured jacket that she was wearing during the day, she's put on a cardigan. If you do have a cardigan, you can wear that. Or we do have certain things like, if you have a scarf like this, then you can, something that you can put in your handbag as well, and at night you put that. Then necklaces, and she's got a very nice necklace here, which for some people they can wear during the day, but at night it just adds on a certain thing. You can put a brooch if you want, and we put the belt, and you can see also a cocktail ring and a bracelet. Nice earrings as well. Coming to myself, I haven't done a lot, but you can, I'll give you an idea of what you do. This is actually a mini dress, which I was wearing as a top. So at night, you just remove your leggings or your pants. If you're comfortable enough to wear minis, then you go ahead, or you can wear tights. Then you change your shoes, which I haven't done, but you can change your shoes into something appropriate for the night. Then remove the jacket, put something with bling, something with a sequins, something with a shine. Then you change up your makeup as well. I think I've got red lipstick. You can add another coat of lipstick if you want. Put more glitter, shine, highlight, change the look of your eyes. I've got bracelets, change up. Just add things that work at night. Then one of the things, I've got also outfits here. For example, with this outfit, you can wear, can you just hold it for me? You can wear it during the day, because if for example, we remove the belt, then this is just the norm, something that you can wear during the day. But then the addition of something shiny and just something shiny makes it move to the night. So even in your outfits, you can look at whatever outfits you've got, as long as you get something that's appropriate for the night, you can go ahead. Things like this. This is a nice top, and it's not that heavy, because if you're wearing a skirt or pants, then at night you just remove the normal shirt that you're wearing, add this up, and it will take you to the night. And these are things that you can carry with you in your handbag, like I say, instead of having to rush to go and get something else. And one of the things you have to remember with changing your day look into nighttime, like I say, maybe because of time or budget, you don't have to go and start buying completely new outfits. Just look at what you have and try, use accessories or change up things. If you normally wear, for example, with Matilda, if she normally wears this dress with maybe these shoes, next time she goes to another function, she can change up her earrings, her necklace, change up, put on something, maybe a nice cropped top or a jacket, and change the shoes. With a black dress, every woman should have a black dress. This will take you everywhere. If you put, you can remove, adding things, removing things changes the look of the outfit.
I am going straight to my wardrobe to do exactly what Jobe was doing, to turn my dress around. You won't recognize it in the daytime when it turns to that nighttime black dress. This has been it for Woman 360 this week. Join me again next week for another pleasant Woman 360. Thank you so much.